release our cares to the Lord and leave them there is evidence of the faith we have in Him.
Israel.
So on the first day of the seventh month, Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly, which was made up of men and women who were able to understand. He read it aloud from daybreak till noon as he faced the square before the water gate, in the presence of the men, women, and others who could understand. And all the people listened attentively to the book of the law. Ezra the scribe stood on a high wooden platform built for the occasion. Beside him on his right stood Mattathiah, Shema, Ananiah, Uriah, Hilkiah, and Maaseiah. And on his left were Padaiah, Mishael, Malkijah, Hashem, Hashbada, Zechariah, and Meshulam. Ezra opened the book. All the people could see him because he was standing above them as he opened it. The people all stood up. Ezra praised the Lord, the great God, and all the people lifted their hands and responded, "Amen, amen." Then they bowed down and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. The Levites, Jeshua, Bani, Sherebiah, Jacob, Achab, Shabbatai, Hodai, Messiah, Kalita, Azariah, Josabad, Hannah, and Peliah. I wonder where guys like Joe and Bill are. Instructed the people in the law, where the book where the people were standing there. They read from the book of the law, making it clear and giving the meaning so that the people could understand what was being read. Then Nehemiah, the governor, Ezra the priest and the scribe, and the Levites who were instructing the people, said to them all, "This day is sacred to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep." For all the people had been weeping as they listened to the words of the law. Nehemiah said, "Go and enjoy choice food and sweet drinks, and send some to those who have nothing prepared. This day is sacred to our Lord. Do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength." The Levites calmed all the people, saying, "Be still, for this is a sacred day. Do not grieve." And with that, we come, in fact, to the last chapter in the Old Testament of our story series. And we will leave this series after today, and then come back to it sometime early next year and begin going through the New Testament chapters. But for today, we consider the idea that it's time to stop crying. And you'll understand what I mean by that in just a moment. In the book of Ecclesiastes, you don't have to turn there. Chapter 3 teaches us that there is a time for everything. And there is, in fact, a time to mourn and a time to weep. But like Ezra and Nehemiah and the Levites said, it's time, perhaps, to stop crying, to move past some of the things that have plagued us, to lay some of those things aside, because they're already dealt with. First of all, there is a time to weep in repentance for our sin. But once you have repented, it's time to stop crying. It says in James 4, "Come near to God, and He will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and He will lift you up." Make no mistake. Scripture is correct when it says all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and that the wages of sin is death. Our sin, individually, as we are reminded of it and the Lord points it out to us, is supposed to make us grieve. It's supposed to make us weep. It's supposed to make us go before the Lord in repentance. It's supposed to make us, as James wrote, grieve, wail, and mourn. However, the Bible says in 1 John 1:8, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Having humbled yourself before God, let us do what James said in the verse I read a moment ago in chapter 4, verse 10. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and He will lift you up. God Himself says, come now, let us reason together. Though your sins are like scarlet, they will be as white as snow. And the psalmist writes in the 103rd chapter, for as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is His love for those who fear Him. So far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us. So here's why it's important for us to stop weeping over confessed sin. Having confessed your sins to God, only you and the devil remember them. God places them in a place called the sea of forgetfulness, removing them from you as far as the east is from the west. I understand regret. I understand sorrow over past actions, and I understand the consequences that inevitably come into our lives when we sin. Those have to be dealt with as mature adults. And my father taught me and his father before him, the essence of being a man is standing and taking responsibility. And so I advocate that. But I do not advocate continuing to carry around the guilt of sin that has been confessed. And if you are walking through life remembering sin that you already brought to the Lord and asked forgiveness for, there are only two sources for that to come from. Either it's you who needs to lay that burden down, or it's the devil who is using that memory against you. Neither of those is good. And you and I are not designed to carry either of those. Now, if you have sin that is not confessed, I urge you not to leave this beautiful sanctuary before you've confessed it. Not to me, not to this church, but to God Almighty, who has promised He will be faithful to forgive us and cleanse us from that unrighteousness if we confess it to Him. That's why in our church, you all don't refer to me as your priest. With all due respect to those who have a priestly tradition, I'm not your priest. I'm your pastor. I can't forgive you or absolve you of your sin. I can pray for you. I can show you scripture. I can kneel beside you and weep along with you. But that's the extent of it. You go work directly to God. The beauty of it is, don't tell anybody, but you don't need a pastor. You can go to God directly in the power and name of Jesus Christ the Lord and say, Lord, I'm sorry. I confess that I have lived against your way. I have done those things that you said not to. I have not done those things that you told me to do. And I am sorry. And I confess that. And having done that, stop weeping over it. Lay it down at the altar or at your bedside or at that table or in your car or wherever you confess it. Lay it down and leave it and walk away from it clean. Secondly, there is a time to passionately take our cares and concerns before the Lord. But once we have, it's time to stop crying. Now, this sermon could come across as an anti-crying message, and that is not it at all. My wife can tell you that my grandfather that I refer to often was a crier. He was a great man of God, a Baptist deacon for over 50 years, and the best Bible teacher I ever had, from my childhood up until the Lord took him home. But he would cry over everything. He was a crier. And unfortunately, that's the one aspect of my grandpa I didn't really want that I've got. The tears come sometimes The Lord moves in a way. I am not at all against that, folks. Don't misunderstand this. And I understand, too, that sometimes our hearts are so heavy with cares and concerns that we are forced to tears. They come. And they are, we're told, good for us. The tears actually relieve some of the stress. Some physicians believe that in weeping, you actually remove some of the chemical residue from the adrenaline that gets released during a crisis. I just read that a couple weeks ago. And it could be that that's actually helping to cleanse your body. So if you need a good cry, have it. But at some point, it has to stop. Hannah wept before the Lord because she couldn't have children. Job wept in the midst of his suffering. Jeremiah wept over the destruction of Jerusalem. Mary and Martha wept at the gravesite of their brother Lazarus. And Peter wept after he had disowned Jesus and felt the sting of that disgrace. And every one of those situations eventually concluded. It resolved itself. Like the comedian Mark Lowry is so fond of saying, my favorite passage from the Bible is, it came to pass. Those situations in life will resolve. They will conclude because God is sovereign. There is a time for weeping there before the Lord, but when the time has passed, it's time to stop. When I take my concerns before God and I lay them out before Him, I need to respond the way King David did. I love what King David did. This episode occurred shortly after his adulterous affair with Bathsheba. And while I will never understand all the whys and the wherefores, God told him that the child that was conceived as a result of the adultery would not live. And David prayed. And he prayed. And he prayed some more. He spent days in the temple, laid out over the altar, weeping and sobbing. He was inconsolable. His attendants couldn't get him to eat or sleep or anything else. He stayed there praying for his child. And then the child died. And he had been so despondent up until that point and so intense in his prayers that his attendants were afraid to tell him the child had died. They were afraid of what he might do. But finally, one of them got the courage. And when they told him, the scripture says this. 2 Samuel chapter 12. Then David got up from the ground. After he had changed and washed, he put on lotions and clean clothes and went to the house of the Lord and worshipped. He laid it down. And then it says, he went to his own house and at his request, they served him food, and he ate. I know there is suffering among us because we're all humans. I know there are issues that perhaps you're dealing right now, and they can't be laid down because you're right in the midst of it. And maybe you're weeping either inside or outside. I get that. And that is allowed and encouraged and healthy, according to Scripture. But to carry it and to carry it and to carry it beyond the altar where we laid it down to our ever faithful Heavenly Father is not something we're designed for. There is a time for weeping and mourning and wailing, but once we release it, our ability to release our cares to the Lord and leave them there is evidence of the faith we have in Him. It's a measure of our relationship. And then finally, life can be difficult. But remember what Nehemiah said. It is time to stop crying. I love his words in Nehemiah 8:10. Go and enjoy choice food and sweet drinks and send some to those who have nothing prepared. This day is sacred to our Lord. Do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. It's in the joy that we feel strong. It's in that spiritual joy that God gives us. I know that in the church, for generations, we've been taught we're supposed to be serious. Sometimes we look like we suck green persimmons on the way to church. I'd like to turn that on its ear. Who but us has reason to rejoice? Who but us is supposed to celebrate every single day of the life that God gives us? Who but us can rejoice that our sins have been forgiven, that we serve a sovereign God who will see us through even if we don't know how? Who of us is going to be really happy? And so I challenge you, enjoy your life. Live it. I do way more funerals than I should. And that's one thing I always tell those who attend. You be sure that you live your life. Live it to its fullest. So that when it does end, and you transfer from this place to the next, you can say, I'm finished with this one. Leave nothing behind. Accept Jesus as your Savior if you have not already done so. And if you don't know how, I will love to sit down and talk with you about it. Worship God at every opportunity. With the church that you're blessed to be part of, with your family, and individually. Invest lavishly and without hesitation in others. Give yourself freely to those that you're privileged to love. Work hard so you can take care of those that are your family. And help those in need when you come across them. Why? Because not just this day, but every day is sacred unto the Lord. And it is time to lay it down and stop crying. I'm not advocating stoicism. I'm not advocating denial. I'm not telling you to put on a happy face if it's not real. I am certainly not telling those who are dealing with diagnosed clinical depression to get over it. I'm not a doctor, I'm a preacher. And I know that's real. I am, however, advocating a faith response to life. That is the most appropriate and real way you can respond to any circumstance. I'm inviting you to take it to the Lord.
Song, the one's turning, just the sound of your name. beautiful thing.